Amen. You may be seated. And let's turn in our Bibles now to the book of Romans. We're continuing our study through this letter that Paul wrote to the people of Rome. Before he ever got a chance to go there, to teach them many things. And as we continue, we're kind of taking a beating here. Kind of taking a beating in the first three chapters of the book of Romans, because Paul is really talking about the fact in the first part of the book of Romans, he's talking about how all people are sinners and we all need the gospel. Amen? If you don't believe that, you're not saved. You hear me? If you don't believe that you're a sinner, you need the gospel, you're not saved. You're not headed for heaven. And that's what Paul's been trying to make the case for here in the first couple of chapters. We've been through the first two chapters. And back in Romans chapter 1, he talked about the pagan man who lives this wild, sinful, ungodly life. He commits all these really bad sins, and everybody looks at him, and everybody knows that he's not going to escape the judgment of God. But then in the beginning of Romans chapter 2, Paul started talking about people who seem to be outwardly moral, even outwardly religious, and Paul told them that they're just as guilty as the pagan man because they're not perfect. They've broken God's law too, and they're not going to escape the judgment of God either. And then last Sunday, as we came down to the end of Romans chapter 2, Paul turned his attention toward the religious Jewish person. And the Jews were among the most religious people that have ever lived on this planet. I mean, nobody had more religion than they did. They had more religion and ceremony than anybody in the world. And Paul still he turns to them, and he warns them that even with all their knowledge and all their religion and all their ceremony, Paul still turns to them and said, "You guys are lost too, because you have failed to keep the law of God. You've not fulfilled the law of God, and just like everyone else, you need the gospel, just like everyone else." And so everybody that Paul has looked at so far, that's the message that Paul's had for him. We're all sinners, and we all need the gospel. And Paul said to the religious Jewish man back there in chapter 2 and verse 28, he said to them that he is not a Jew who is one outwardly, nor is circumcision that which is outward in the flesh. In other words, you can't get right with God through outward religion or outward religious ceremonies. You can go through all that religious ritual and still be just as lost as you were in the first place. You can get baptized. But if there wasn't something that happened within, you just got wet. You understand what I'm saying? Now, all that outward ritual, and Paul went on in Romans 2:29, he said, "But he is a Jew who is one inwardly, and circumcision is that of the heart, in the spirit and not in the letter, whose praise is not from men, but from God." And Paul's talking about a spiritual reality. He's not talking about being a Jew by descent. He's talking about being part of the Israel of God. He's talking about knowing Him. And you need something to take place, not on the outside of your body where men can see it, but within your heart and within your spirit where only God can see it. Until you're made new from within by the power of the gospel message of Jesus Christ, all the outward religion in the world can't help you. It may look good from the outside in the eyes of men, but God looks upon the heart, right? God can see who we are in our inner being. And so Paul looks to the religious Jewish person and he says, "Your connection to Israel can't save you, and your knowledge and your teaching of the law can't save you, and even your obedience to religious ritual like the covenant of circumcision can't save you either, because you are sinners. You have failed to fulfill God's law, so you need the gospel just like everybody else in the world." That's what Paul has been making clear. Man, people are just taking a beating here in the first couple of chapters. And now we're moving into chapter 3 this morning, and we're going to keep on taking a beating this morning. But that's what has to happen. If a person wants to be saved, we have to realize the truth that we're sinners and we need the gospel. And the problem is when you confront religious people, when you confront people that love their religion, people that think their religion makes them good, and you tell them that even with all their religion and even with all the ceremonies that they've been through, that they're still not good people in the sight of God and they're still lost, they might just get offended at you and they might get a little defensive. And as Paul was writing this letter, he already knew that fact very well. because he'd already tried to share the gospel with many religious Jewish people. And many of them had become very angry with him as he talked about that truth to them. As he shared the gospel with them, many of them had become angry with Paul. And you can read the history about a lot of those conflicts where Paul was sharing the gospel and Jewish religious people got angry with him. You read through the book of Acts and you'll see that kind of thing in Acts chapter 9. You see it in Acts chapter 13. You're going to see it again in Acts chapter 14, Acts chapter 15, Acts chapter 17, Acts chapter 18. You really see it in Acts chapter 21 when he goes down to Jerusalem. He gets arrested and he gets shipped off towards trying to get to Rome. And it's very interesting how we see all that work out. But pretty much all the way through the book of Acts, from the time that Paul gets saved and he's starting to share the gospel, every time he would travel from city to city and preach the gospel, it was the religious Jews that rose up in anger to oppose him for his message. And he really suffered a lot of persecution at their hands. And you see, the thing about the gospel message is that it confronts people with their sin. You understand that this morning? The gospel message confronts us all with our sin. The gospel message tells us, guys, listen, the gospel message tells us that our sin is so bad, Jesus had to die for it. Jesus, and so our sin that we've committed against God is so bad that we deserve the death penalty. That's what the gospel tells us. And that doesn't make us feel very good about ourselves. The thing that we can be happy and rejoice in is that God loved us enough to send his son, and Jesus suffered that death penalty for us. And as Christians who realize we're sinners, as Christians who realize that we're not perfect and we can accept this truth that we're sinners and we need the gospel is a joyous message to us, but the gospel message offends people who are religious and still in love with their religion, and they think that their religion is going to save them, and it offends them so badly. Even Paul says in Galatians chapter 5 and verse 11, Paul says that the message of the cross is an offense for which he had suffered much persecution. He had been arrested, he'd been beaten, he'd been jailed, he'd been stoned and left for dead. I'm not talking about the fun kind of stone that you teenagers do, but he'd been stoned, hit with rocks, you know, he was passed out, and they left him for dead, but, you know, the Lord raised him up. And he'd done a lot of suffering simply because many of the religious Jews became very angry with him when he was trying to share the gospel message. They heard that message, it made them angry, they didn't feel good about themselves. They didn't feel good about how he was saying they stood before God. And so what all this tells us is that Paul had already been through all these arguments, and he'd been through all the debates, and he'd heard all the arguments from the angry Jewish religious leaders. And so as we're making our way through this next passage of Scripture, we're going to be in Romans chapter 3. And I apologize, in your bulletin, at the top of the sermon notes on the back, I apologize, we have the wrong scripture text up there. It's actually, instead of being back in Romans 2, which was a scripture text last week, it's supposed to be Romans chapter 3, verses 1 through 9. It's totally my bad, my fault, so you can scratch through that scripture text, but Romans 3, 1 through 9. Now, down in the notes, you're going to find the right scripture references, so that'll be okay. We can fix that with just a little mark out if you want to. If anybody needs to borrow a pen, you can borrow one from me or Miss Bridget. I have one right here. Anyway, just Romans 3, 1 through 9 is where we're going to be this morning. But Paul's already been through all the arguments. And so as we start to go through this next section of Scripture today, we're going to see that Paul already knows that there are a lot of people who are going to read this letter, and they're not going to like what Paul is saying here. They're not going to like what it says about their standing before God. And so they're going to be arguing with Paul in their minds. And since Paul's not there yet, he can't be there to answer their arguments face to face. He's just going to go ahead and answer these arguments in this letter ahead of time. And so I want to take you through this. I want to show you how he addresses all these arguments that he knows the religious Jewish person is always going to bring up after he presents the gospel. He's going to go through all those arguments, and he's going to address each one of those arguments, answer some of them, and just kind of put some of them to rest. And so I want to take you through this. I want to show you. And as we look at each one of these questions and how Paul deals with them, what we're going to see is that Paul is really defending the character of God himself. Because what's happening is as the religious leaders of Israel are arguing with him, they are really attacking God's character in these questions that they're asking. And they're really attacking the gospel itself. And so Paul is going to defend God's character in the way that God gave the gospel to the world. He's going to talk about how good God was to the people of Israel. And what many of these religious Jews are angry about, they're saying, they're acting like, well, if this gospel is true, then God has somehow been unfaithful to them. And Paul is going to put that lie to rest. Okay, so three major points we're going to see in this text. Three major things that Paul's going to show us here. Number one, if you're looking at your notes, you want to take notes today. Number one, God has not forsaken his people for the sake of his purpose. That's number one. God has not forsaken his people, Israel, for the sake of his purpose. Right? So let's go back. Let's go to Romans 3:1, and we're going to read it in the scripture. Here's the question that the Jewish religious person is asking after Paul has shared the gospel. They say, what advantage then has the Jew, or what is the profit of circumcision? Remember, Paul's already told them that religion and being a Jew, you don't get saved automatically. And there's people who aren't Jews. There's people who haven't gone through all your religion, who know the Lord in their hearts, and they're saved without all your religious tradition and all your religious ceremony. They're saved. And so the Jew comes back, they're angry, and they say, well, what good is it to be a Jew? What good is it to have all this religion? What profit is circumcision? And so here we have the first objection to the gospel from the religious Jew who's offended by it. And understand what they're asking. If this gospel declares that Jews are no better than Gentiles, and if it puts all of us on the same level before God, that we're all just sinners who need to be saved by grace, yet hasn't God spoken great things in the scripture concerning the nation of Israel? I mean, throughout the Old Testament, didn't God say to Abraham back in Genesis chapter 12, he says, I will make of you a great nation, and you'll be a blessing, and you'll be blessed, and you'll be a blessing, and in you all the families of the earth will be blessed. And didn't God say in Deuteronomy 14:2 that Israel would be a holy people to the Lord, and that he had chosen them to be a people, a special people for himself, a special treasure above all the peoples of the earth who are on the face of the earth? And didn't God command the Israelite men to observe that rite of circumcision as a sign of their covenant relationship to God? And if all people, Jew and Gentile alike, are really lost without this gospel message, and if the Gentiles can be saved without ever even experiencing any of our religion, then why did the Israelites go through all that stuff? Was it all worthless? Did God just put us through some kind of pointless exercise? That's what the Jewish religious person is asking here. In response to the gospel message that Paul has shared with him. What advantage then has the Jew? Or what is the profit of circumcision? Now Paul's going to answer that question in verse 2. Beginning in verse 2, Paul says, much. Every way, in every way. What advantage then has the Jew? Much in every way. As Israelites, Paul's made it clear here that going through all that and being a Jewish person, there's a lot of advantages to it. There was a great deal of advantage to being Jews. Listen, the Israelites are a people who've been privileged and honored by God with a great amount of access, greater amount of access than any other nation, to have God himself dwelling in their presence and to hear the Word of God and know the Word of God before any other people did. Right? Am I right? Did God give the Word through Israel? And all those privileges, while all those privileges are a great advantage, one of the things that made them angry, though, here, was that Paul was trying to tell them that those privileges alone cannot save them. Those privileges alone cannot save a person. And let me say it like this. You can't get saved by sitting next to the Word of God. You can't get saved just because you have access to the Word of God. And you can't get saved by sitting next to God Himself. Right? You just can't do it. All those privileges did not save them. And the Israelites lived their lives with all those very special privileges, yet they got very upset when they heard Paul telling them here that those things alone cannot save them. And then another thing that was making them angry was that Paul was telling them that the door was open to the Gentiles to be saved just as much as it was for the Jews to be saved. That ought to make us angry because most of us are Gentiles, right? Right? How many of you are Gentiles? All right? A lot of you. Some of you are like, I don't know. If you're not a Jew, if you're anything else other than a Jew, then the Jews would call you a Gentile, right? So how many of you are Gentiles, right? Right? And I used to have this guy that was in our church in Weatherford, and I said, we're all Gentiles here tonight. And he said, no, I'm a Mexican, you know, so I don't know. I'll tell you. But that's okay. He's a Gentile too, just like me. But this ought to make us kind of upset because there's a group of people who don't think we should have the right to be saved, huh? How does that make you feel? Don't you want the right to be saved? I mean, I want the right to be saved, and I don't think that I should stand up here and be saved and feel like other people shouldn't be able to be saved. And the only reason something like that would make them angry, that the Gentiles are able to come in and be saved, the only reason that would make them angry is because of self-righteousness and pride and envy. Years ago, I was pastor of a small church where we only had one deacon in that church. And he was faithful. He was so faithful. And he did a lot for our church. But as the church grew, we felt the need to bring in some more deacons, and we ordained 3 new deacons to come in and serve right alongside of him. We all thought that was a great thing, but would you believe that that man got his feelings hurt and he left the church? He left the church. And when I sat down to visit with him about it, he told me that, he said, I just don't feel needed anymore. Truth is, we needed him more than ever, because the church was growing and there was a lot more to do. But he allowed his own prideful, bitter feelings to get in the way because he really felt special as the only deacon in the church. And when those other men came in, he felt like he was losing some of that attention that he had been getting as the only deacon. He was going to have to share it with them. And he resented them. And he resented me for letting that happen. And he was one of the finest deacons I ever had the opportunity to work with. But he allowed the prideful feelings to get in the way, and he got bitter and he just quit serving the Lord. It was a real sad thing. And you see, as Paul's sharing the gospel with the Jewish religious people, and they begin to realize that the door for the Gentiles is open so that they can come in and be saved just as much as it was for them, these prideful religious Jews, they got territorial. I told a story years ago about my little dog, Cruz. He's a vicious monster. Right? He is big enough, I promise, his fangs are vicious enough that if you were to put an olive in his mouth, he could crush it. That's how he is mighty. It is one mighty monster. He's part Chihuahua and part Dachshund. And he is vicious. But you know, I will tell you, he will not back down from any fight. He would not back down from anything unless the gate is open. But if the gate is shut, he will go right up to that gate. He will go right up to that gate and he will bark and snarl, and the hair on his back of his neck will stick up, making him about 1/4 inch taller than what he really is. I mean, he will look vicious and he will bark and snarl. He will make a line of pee all the way across that gate to show that this is his territory. If there's another dog on the other side. Now you open that gate, he's going to run inside. You know, he's a coward when they can't get across. But kind of that territorial area. And that's kind of the way these religious Jews felt towards the Gentiles. Don't come in. This is ours. This is our kingdom. This is our kingdom. How dare we be like that? How dare anybody be like that? Christ has invited someone in. We ought to be glad that they came in. And so that's the reaction of the Jewish religious person when he hears the gospel. If we're not any better than the Gentiles with all of our religion, then what advantage do we have being Jews? What advantage? But Paul answered that question. We see his answer there in verse 2. He says, much, everywhere. I mean, I know that these guys feel disappointed that they're not as perfect and they're not as special as they thought they were. They are special, but they have to understand that God has really done a lot of very special things through them and for them. And Paul tells them that they have been given a great deal of advantage in every way, much in every way. And not only does he tell them that, but he also gives them the best example of that he can think of, the greatest. He reminds them of the biggest, most important thing, the most important advantage that God ever gave to the Israelites. You know what that was? Look at verse 3. He says the word chiefly, right? And that means this is the biggest thing God did, right? Chiefly, because to them were committed the oracles of God. And that's the words of God. God took his holy words. God gave us this book, but he gave it through Israel, and they had it first. And they were faithful to write it down and pass it on down. And we have it today because God gave it to them first. And a lot of times you'll find that phrase in the scripture, the Jew first and also the Greek. It came to the Jews. It came to Israel first. So because to them were committed the oracles of God, they got the word of God first. And how could you argue against God? And how could you argue against God's goodness toward Israel in that God gave Israel his word before he gave it to any other people in the world, before anybody else was able to have it, Israel had it. And I would say that God gave Israel a huge advantage in that, right? Are you with me this morning? If I were to dance a little bit, would you wake up a little bit? No, you'd probably throw up a little bit, right? Okay. No, God gave him his word. Is God's word a precious gift? It's a precious gift. And they had it before anybody else in the world could have it. Not only are they upset that the Gentiles are coming in, But I tell you what, one of the things that you got to think about, they're complaining to God that you know they're not automatically saved. They're complaining to God that he's letting in the Gentiles and letting them come in the door too. But what Paul's trying to help them understand is that God has given the Jews a great advantage in that they received his word before anybody else in the world. And yes, the Gentiles can come in the door, but God sure did put Israel closer to the door a lot earlier than he put us by the door. And I would say that is an advantage. That he gave them a great opportunity to come in first, right? Okay? And so they should have recognized that. They should have realized that. They shouldn't stand there and say that, well, God just isn't being fair with us. You can't do that. God's been good to them. Now, the second thing we find out here, and I didn't even give you your first point, but I'm going to now give you your second point, is that God has not forsaken his promise toward his people. God has not forsaken his promise toward his people. Verse 3, he says, for what if some did not believe? Will their unbelief make the faithfulness of God without effect? And this is the second argument from the religious Jewish person who is offended by the gospel. And follow their logic. God made promises to Israel. God promised that he would bring his everlasting kingdom through Israel. And go all the way back to Genesis 12. We already mentioned the covenant that he made with Abraham, the promises he made to Abraham. You can also go back to 2 Samuel and chapter 7, and you see where the Lord spoke to David. And he said, I will appoint a place for my people Israel and will plant them that they may dwell in a place of their own and move no more, nor shall the sons of wickedness oppress them anymore. He also said, I will set up your seed after you. He said to David, who was king at the time, I will set up your seed after you, who will come from your own body, I will establish his kingdom. He shall build a house for my name, and I will establish the throne of his kingdom forever. An everlasting kingdom God promised through Israel, through the seed of David. And these are the promises that God made to David concerning Israel and his kingdom. Yet Paul came along preaching this gospel of Jesus Christ, who, by the way, is the seed of David that's promised there in 2 Samuel chapter 7. But Paul tells them, if you don't believe in Jesus, you're not going to make it into that kingdom. And so that's another thing these religious Jews did not like. They felt like they should automatically be in the door simply because they were Israelites. And so they argue here, isn't God breaking his promise to bring the kingdom through Israel? If your gospel's true, if he doesn't let in the Israelites just because they don't believe in Jesus Christ, has God broken his promise? And I want you to notice Paul's answer in verse 4. Beginning of verse 4, Paul says, certainly not. Not just no, but certainly not. And it's you may have it in your, depending on what translation you're using. If you have a King James, you might see God forbid. You might see the word may it never be, depending on what translation. Mine says certainly not, New King James. And the phrase comes from two Greek words, may geneta. And that those two Greek words, is a, that you put those together, and that's about the strongest way anyone could ever say, no, it's not possible. Right? So if any of you guys want to come ask me if you want to date my youngest daughter, may geneta. Just can't happen. It's impossible. It just can't happen. Paul says when a person is kept out of God's kingdom because of their own unbelief, because they refuse to believe in Jesus, there's no way you can ever come back and blame that on God somehow being unfaithful to his promises. That can't be. Megineta. That can never be. But Paul doesn't just say it can't be. He tells us why. As you continue through verse 4, he says, indeed, let God be true, but every man a liar. You know how many of us are liars in here? All of us. David said, I said in my haste, all men are liars. And you know why David said that in his haste? He was angry with somebody for lying to him. So he said, all men are liars. And he goes, oh yeah, I'm a man. Said that too quickly, right? We're all liars, every one of us. And Paul quotes scripture, he says, but indeed let God be true, but every man a liar. God is true to every word that he says. He'll never let any of his promises fail or fall to the ground. And it would be better for us to question and doubt the faithfulness and honesty of every person in the world than to ever doubt that God would ever say anything that he wouldn't be perfectly true to. God never backs away from his promises. And then notice what Paul does next, because this would have been a powerful argument for these religious Jews to hear. The last part of verse 4, Paul says, as it is written. Now, when you're reading through the New Testament and you come across the words, as it is written, you're reading something Paul said and he says, as it is written. You're reading through the Gospels and Jesus says, as it is written. What does that mean? That means they're quoting scripture from the Old Testament, right? And that's what Paul's doing here. He's quoting a scripture from the Old Testament. Anybody know where this scripture is that Paul's quoting here? I heard somebody say an S. I didn't hear you say the whole word. Psalms, that's right. Psalm 51. Remember the case, what happened in Psalm 51? It was King David. And King David is praying to God and he's repenting and he's confessing of his sins before God. And he's asking God's forgiveness, asking God to cleanse him from his sins of adultery and his sin of deception and his sin of murder and misusing his army. All the terrible things he did as king of Israel there when he was in that sinful state. And he's been caught and he's confessing those sins before God. And here's part of his prayer that Paul quotes. He says that you, God, Paul quotes the section where David is praying to God, and David says that you may be justified in your words and may overcome when you are judged. Now, the The religious Jew offended by the gospel is trying to judge God as unrighteous and unjust. And he's angry that God has not automatically saved him because he's a Jew. And he's angry that he's letting Gentiles into the kingdom through the gospel. And so he's judging God and he's calling God unfair. But Paul takes one of those promises, which we just read a while ago in 2 Samuel chapter 7, which God made a promise to King David, who's the person that Paul's quoting from in Psalm 51, where King David is confessing and repenting of his sins before God, and he's asking God to forgive him and cleanse him of his adultery and his deception and his murder. And that's David, the one that we just read about, to whom God made all those promises concerning Israel and the everlasting kingdom. And just think about how David's praying there. He's not assuming that God owes him anything except judgment and wrath for the sins that he's committed. He's not saying, God, you have to let me in. He's just simply saying, I deserve wrath. And his prayer was that, Lord, if you decide to pour out your wrath on me right now, you would be justified in doing it. You would be absolutely right in doing it. And David would not be able to speak a word against him. That's what David's saying in Psalm 51. And so the message to the religious Jew is that you can't blame God when he punishes you, when he judges you for your unbelief. If you don't believe, the gospel says you're not coming into that kingdom. You can't shift the blame and accuse God of being unfaithful to you because he's always faithful. The only unfaithfulness is in us. That's the only unfaithfulness. Now, thirdly, the third point that Paul makes here is that God has not forsaken his purity for the sake of his purpose. God hasn't taken any impure motives here to get his work done, to get the gospel plan done. And verse 5 is where this is suggested. Verse 5, Paul says, but if our unrighteousness demonstrates the righteousness of God, what shall we say? And that is the third and final argument, the beginning of it anyway, of the religious Jew who's offended by the gospel. And listen to it. Listen to the logic of it. When we as sinners are saved, our unrighteousness, okay? How many of us are unrighteous in ourselves? Unrighteous. We're all unrighteous. When we as sinners are saved, our unrighteousness demonstrates the righteousness of God. All right, you hear that? That is a true statement. It's a statement that Paul's been preaching. We're going to see him talk about it more as we go through the book of Romans, that he gives us a gift of his righteousness. When we are unrighteous and we don't deserve it, he gives us the gift of the righteousness of Jesus Christ. And the worse our unrighteousness, the worse our sin problem, the brighter his righteousness shines. That is, when God saves a very wicked sinner, the more wicked that sinner is, the more glorious God's grace shines. We see him save a drug addict, a prostitute, a criminal, a murderer. Then we rejoice all the more in how big and wonderful the grace, the glorious grace of our God is. Where sin did abound, Romans 5, grace did much more abound. And the deeper the sin, the more we glorify God and we praise him. We see God save a sinner, we just give him glory. And so that's a true statement, right? Our unrighteousness demonstrates the righteousness of God. And so the religious Jew grabs on that and they go, okay, well, what are we supposed to say to that? Now, a sinner like me, right? A sinner like me who recognizes his guilt really loves that truth. Okay? I love it. That's good news. That's good news for us. That God's going to give me his grace. He's going to give me the gift of his righteousness. As bad a sinner as I was, he saved me and poured his grace on me. I love that truth. But the prideful religious man who thinks his religion makes him a good person He hates that truth. He wants to go on. He wants to continue believing that he's a good person through his religion. So he refuses to believe in a grace like that. And that's why he'll fight against it. Not only that, he'll hurl insults and accusations at a grace like this. And so we're going to see how they do that. Look at the next part of the argument, verse 5. If our unrighteousness demonstrates the righteousness of God, what shall we say? Is God unjust who inflicts wrath? Let me say it to you like this. When God saves us from our sin, his goodness is demonstrated and he gets glorified, right? That looks good on God. We praise him because he saves us from our sin. So here's the question from the religious Jew. So aren't we really doing something good for God when we sin? You hear what they're saying? And if that's the case, then wouldn't God be unjust and unfair to inflict wrath upon us? And what we're beginning to see here is the kind of the Judas argument, right? Judas, remember, he betrayed Jesus Christ, right? He didn't believe in him, and he betrayed him for 30 pieces of silver. And when we look at that story, you know, we know that it all played out according to God's plan. And so Judas had not done this. Christ is not betrayed. He doesn't go to the cross. And so in a way, Judas is actually doing something to help God, right? And so why should Judas be punished? That's kind of the argument that they're bringing. But really, ask yourself, is this really a question? Here's where we get down to the point of what these guys are trying to do. What they're trying to do is pick apart the gospel. This is not a serious question that deserves a serious answer. I believe this is the response of a prideful religious person who's bitter towards the gospel. And it's not so much a real question it's a statement that's mocking the grace of the gospel. And I don't believe it's a serious question that deserves a serious answer, because Paul doesn't really give it a serious answer. He just rebukes it with truth. That's what Paul does. And I want to show you how he does that. First of all, first thing Paul does is he distances himself from that kind of thought. Because you see it right there at the end of verse 5. As Paul say there, he says, I speak as what? A man. He's giving that argument. And he says, I speak as a man. Okay, Paul doesn't want anybody to misunderstand him. He doesn't want anybody to think that he thinks that way. And so he says, I'm speaking here as a man. Christians don't think that way. Christians don't speak this way. It's not right for us to doubt God's righteousness. It's not right for us to call God's justice into question. So Paul makes it clear, I don't think like that. And the only reason I'm even talking about those kinds of ideas is so that I can teach the self-righteous religious Jew that he's wrong to think this way. Right? So he's distanced himself from that kind of thinking. That's not me. That's a religious Jew, prideful, saying that. And then Paul kind of comes out and says, okay, is that true? Has God wronged to punish somebody who's just glorifying him by allowing them to save him from his sin? Is it wrong for God to punish somebody that's sinned because we're really just doing God a favor? And in verse 6, Paul gives him the answer. What is it? Certainly not. Again, me genata. Same words, the same answer that he gave a while ago. That is not possible. It's the strongest way you can say that can never be. What you're suggesting just cannot happen. No, God does not want people to commit more sins so that he can receive more glory when he saves them. Now, he wants to save people, but he doesn't want them to commit more sins before they get there. He's not going to reward them. He's not going to withhold judgment. If they don't believe, he's going to punish them. Paul poses a question here. That was the case. In verse 6, he says, for then how will God judge the world? Okay, what you're asking is absolutely ridiculous. If God cannot punish people because their sin in the long run glorifies God, then how's God ever going to judge the world? And we know from the scripture that he does judge people, and that puts that argument to rest right there. Certainly not, because God is going to judge the world. How could God stand in judgment against our impure and unjust ways if he had impure and unjust motives himself? No, the God who stands over us as judge is pure and righteous and holy. And he doesn't want any of us to sin, no matter how awesome it makes him appear to the world when he saves us. Now listen to what Paul says here, because this helps us understand. He's going to take the argument a little further. It helps us understand the way these self-righteous religious Jews were attacking the gospel of grace. Imagine one of these Jews saying this to Paul here. In verse 7, he says, "For if the truth of God has increased through my lie to his glory," right? And that's a good result. God gets glory when I do a sin like tell a lie. And his truth increases and he gets glory. "If the truth of God has increased through my lie to his glory, why am I also still judged as a sinner? And why not say, let us do evil that good may come?" Okay, do you see what these guys are saying here? They're not serious about these questions. They're not seeking answers. They're not trying to learn or understand. They're just attacking the gospel of grace. Here's what they're doing. They're saying, "Paul, we have a good religion that teaches people how to be good people. But your gospel is so full of grace that it just lets people get away with all the wickedness they want to. And God will save them." They're mocking that kind of grace. They're mocking it. And that's why Paul says there at the end of verse 8, he says, "As we are slanderously reported, and as some affirm that we say." So there's people actually going around here that I'm telling people that you can commit whatever wickedness you want. It's okay that my gospel encourages people to commit wickedness. Paul says, "No, that's slander. You're slandering me by saying that kind of thing." Those religious men, they won't let go of their pride. They won't let go of the idea that they can somehow be good enough in the sight of God. And they hate this message from Paul that says they can't, that you have to depend on the grace of God. And so they respond by slandering and attacking Paul. And they are slandering and attacking the gospel message which he preaches, claiming that he preaches a message that encourages men to sin as much as they want. We're going to see this again in Romans chapter 6. Paul's going to answer again. "Shall we continue in sin that grace may abound? God forbid. How shall we that are dead to sin continue to live any longer therein?" The gospel doesn't encourage us to sin more so we can be forgiven and God can be glorified. No, no, no. The gospel saves us from our sin and encourages us to look up to God with a grateful heart and want to live for him for the rest of our lives and lay our lives at his feet. I've got a little dyslexic there. Lay our lives at his feet. We're going to say our feet at his lives. Our lives at his feet as an offering. The gospel encourages us to do that. To obey him. Not to sin. Paul says, not at all. And verse 8. One more thing he says in verse 8. These people are saying this. Notice he hasn't really addressed the question that much. But here's what he says at verse 8. These people that are saying this, he says, "Their condemnation is just." So Paul responds to them with less of an answer and more of a warning. These guys are not serious about seeking answers. They're not trying to understand. They simply hate and have rejected the gospel message. And now they're attacking it. And Paul warns them, "Your condemnation is just." Sometimes when you're trying to share the gospel with people and they get so stubborn-hearted against it, so hard-hearted against it, the only thing left that a person can do is you can just say, "Listen, my friend, you're going to have to stand before God one day. You're going to be judged by him." And that brings us down to the conclusion of this little section of Scripture. So what have we figured out? He started out asking, does the Jew have any advantage? Listen, just a few more minutes. I'm about to quit. Don't give up on me. What then? We started out asking, does the Jew have an advantage? And he says, sure. They have a big advantage. They got the Word of God first, and that's a big, big advantage among many other things. But what then? Are we better than they? No. Not at all. Not at all. For we have previously charged Jews and Greeks, Jews and Gentiles, that they are all under what? Sin. Right? And so again, it's the same conclusion we've been arriving at over and over. The pagan man in chapter 1 is sinful and deserving of death. In chapter 2, the moral and religious man is sinful and deserving of death. Now the religious Jew, we've concluded, he's also sinful and worthy of death. And so what? We all need the gospel message. Aren't you glad Jesus Christ came?